A Flower Out of Place, with your host, Glen Sherley.
As a Greystone chapel in Folsom. My name
starring
is
Johnny Cash.
How do you do?
Roy Clark.
I've been
Foster Brooks.
I've been drinking all day.
Linda Ronstadt. And the 2,000 inmates of the Tennessee State Penitentiary.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash, and this is a Tennessee State Prison in Nashville. Today is one of the proudest moments of my life, the culmination of a dream that began a little over 6 years ago in a place a lot like this one at Folsom Prison, California. That was on February 11th, 1968. I'd gone to Folsom to perform for the inmates there, and that morning on stage, I did a song that I'd set up most of the night learning, a song written by a man named Glen Sherley. That's S-H-E-R-L-E-Y, Glen Sherley, an inmate there at Folsom Prison. Today, Glenn's a free man, working hard, doing good. For today, he's hosting his own television special, and he chose to do it here at the Tennessee State Prison. That's why I'm here, and I'm mighty proud to be a part of it.
A Flower Out of Place, from the Tennessee State Prison in Nashville, Tennessee, with special guest comedian Foster Brooks, special sweetheart Linda Ronstadt, special guest star, Roy Clark, and a very special friend, Johnny Cash.
Yeah. I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around a bend. And I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on. But that train keeps rolling on down to San Antonio. Well, when I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry.
Get up! Vamos!
From this prison, if that railroad train was mine, I bet I'd move it on a little farther down the line, far from Folsom Prison. That's where I want to stay. And I'd let that lonesome whistle blow my blues away.
Thank you very much. When I first laid eyes on Glen Sherley, I was on stage at Folsom Prison, and he was on the front row. I singled him out that day by saying, Glen Sherley, this is your song, and then I sang it. Today I'm going to single him out by saying, Glen Sherley, this is your show, do it. Here he is, Glen Sherley.
I'd like to try and do this song for you that made it all possible. Thanks to John.
As a Greystone chapel here in Folsom, it's a house of worship in this den of sin. You wouldn't think God had a place
here at Folsom. But he saved the soul of many lost men. Now this great stone chapel here at Folsom stands 100 years old, made of granite rock. It takes a ring of keys to move here at Folsom, but the door to the house of God is never locked. Inside the walls of prison, my body may be, but my Lord has set my soul free. There's men here that don't ever worship, and there's men here who scoff at the ones who pray. I've got down on my knees in that Greystone chapel, and I thank the Lord for helping me each day. Now this Greystone chapel here at Folsom has the touch of God's hand on every stone. It's the flower of light in a field of darkness, and it's given me the strength to carry on. Inside the walls of prison, my body may be, my Lord has set my soul free. But my Lord has set my soul free.
Thank you very much. Hello out there, and welcome to our show here tonight at the Tennessee State Prison, Nashville, Tennessee, Music City, USA. And a special hello to each and every one of you in here.
A Flower Out of Place will return with Roy Clark, Linda Ronstadt, and Foster Brooks right after this message.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I tell you what, welcome back. Lord, I'm glad you stayed with us, and y'all will be too, because we're honored to have with us tonight a man whose distinguished service and dedication to the American penal system has earned him the position, the esteemed position, I'd say, of Warden of the Year, 1974. Let's put our hands together and make him welcome, Mr. Foster Brooks.
Okay, fellas, fun is fun, but who's got my wallet? That's not going to do you any good. It doesn't have any money in it, and by the time you get out of here, the credit cards will be expired. Gentlemen, I want you to know that it's a real pleasure to be here with you today and to speak to you and thank any of those of you who are responsible for me being selected as a warden. And I would, as you know, that when a stranger from the outside comes in to visit with you gentlemen, they go through a little whatever it is. I guess they call it a shakedown. Well, I've had in my lifetime a number of physical examinations from the best doctors in the world, but nobody ever touched me like that guard out there did. I want to apologize to each and every one of you, because I'm not in the habit of walking before an audience in this condition. In fact, I'm not in the habit of walking anywhere in this condition. I feel I must say that I have a very good reason for being loaded tonight. I've been drinking all day. I was celebrating the fact that just yesterday morning, I became the father of a 6-pound baby girl, and I know I'm going to catch heck if my wife finds out about it. When I was speaking of my wife, I don't want to mislead any of you fellows, because I've been married more than once. In fact, I've been married three times. But my first two wives each died a very, very tragic death. My first wife died from eating poison mushrooms. And my second wife died from a fractured skull. She wouldn't eat her mushrooms. Well, I don't know. I was just thinking about my brothers-in-law back in Buffalo, and they're real nice guys, you know, and one of them, about 4 years ago, for the first time in his life, he went ice fishing, brought home 200 pounds of ice. His wife fried it, and they both drowned. The last winter when we were there, one of my brothers-in-law likes to fish, you know, and he came in. I was sitting in the living room, and he was out in the kitchen, and he wanted me to go fishing with him. So he came into me and he said,
"Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear
Foster." I said, "What?" He said, "Do you want to go fishing?" And I said, "Yeah,
yeah."
So we went fishing, and it was in the wintertime. We were fishing through the ice,
you know.
And we were sitting there fishing through this little hole in the ice, and all of a sudden a couple of guys came whizzing by in one of those snowmobiles. My brother-in-law looked up and said, "That's what we ought to be doing." I said, "What?" He said, "Trolling."
Guest does so many things so well that I don't know whether to call him a very funny man, a super guitarist, or a funny super guitar figure that sings well. But I think Country Music Association here knew what they were doing when they named him Entertainer of the Year, because he's a super bunch of everything. Let's make him welcome, Mr. Roy Clark.
Appreciate it. One nail in the house and I hung on it. Hey, where were you last Saturday night? While I was lying in jail.
out walking up and down the road. With another man. You wouldn't even go my bail. Sweet baby's arms. I ain't gonna work on the railroad. I ain't gonna work on the farm. I'm gonna lay around the shack till the mail train comes back. And I roll in my sweet baby's arms. Roll in my sweet baby's arms. Roll in my sweet baby's arms. I'm gonna lay around the shack till the mail train comes back. And I roll in my sweet baby's arms. Your parents, they don't like me. They drove me away from your door. And if I had my life to live over, I'd never go there anymore. My sweet baby's arms, rolling my sweet baby's arms. I'm gonna lay around the shack till the mail train comes back. Then I roll in my sweet baby's arms.
Thank you.
Thank my coach and the rest of the team for this award.
It's not an award, it's a banjo. I bet you knew that right off. I had a pretty good suspicion my own self. I just don't like to take chances anymore. For the first 4 years, I thought it was a growth. Some of you folks may recognize Buck Trent. That's over here playing the banjo. For 11 years, he picked with Porter Wagner. Well, since the first of the year, he's been picking with me, and that's the way it's gonna be from now on. Somewhere tonight, Porter's out picnics. I'll tell you how strange I am. I had my choice between Dolly Parton and him. I took Buck. You're trainable. I can work with you. Buck and I'd like to do a little thing, if we may, call shucking the corn. Right.
Mr. Jerry Jernigan.
We're fortunate enough to have on the show tonight. She's a lovely lady for being here. Let's make her welcome, Miss Linda Ronstadt.
Be happy.
represent one of the most exciting groups you will be able to see anywhere. Let's bring them on with a big hand, the Outlaws.
Let's make him welcome,
Mr. Johnny Cash.
I'd like to thank all the people back here, the inmates that have helped us in our part of the show. It's really been a pleasure for us. This is the second time we've been out here. We missed some fine people. And we wish you the best of luck, and God bless you.
I wish I had someone to love me, someone to call me their own. Don't I wish I had someone to live with? 'Cause I'm tired of living alone. Bees meet me tonight, lover meet me. Please meet me tonight, all alone. For I have a sad story to tell you. It's a story that's never been told. I'll be carried to that big jail tomorrow, leaving my little darling all alone. With the cold prison walls all around me, would fly. I would fly to the arms of my darling.
How much longer will it be till we cross that Mason-Dixon line? When we get Dixie, will you tell that engineer to ring his bell and ask everybody that ain't asleep to stand right up here? Hey, porter, hey, porter, what time did you say? How much longer will it be till I can see the light of day? When we hit Dixie, will you tell that engineer to ring his bell and ask everybody that ain't asleep to stand right up in the air? Guitar now, Bob Woods. Open up the door. When I stop this train, I'm gonna get off first, cause I can't wait no more. Tell an engineer, said thanks a lot, and I didn't mind the fare. Gonna set my feet on the southern soil and breathe that southern air. Wow. Gave him his orders at Monroe, Virginia. Said, Steve, you're way behind time. This is not 38, this is all 97. Put her in the spencer on time. And then he turned around and said to his big greasy fireman, shovel on a little more coal. And when we cross that white oak mountain, watch old 97 run. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Carl Perkins. And then a telegram came to Washington Station. This is what it said. It said that brave engineer that run on 97 is lying down in Danville, dead. Poor boy. Coming down that railroad track. Hey, now look yonder coming down that railroad track. That's that orange blossom special, bringing my baby back.
was hanging around the switch yards in New York City with a bunch of other hobos, minding my own business like I always do, when a man with a badge come up to me and he said,
"Hey, boy, what are you hanging around here for?"
And I said, "For whatever's going around, I'll have some." He said, "You're a smart aleck, ain't you, boy?" And I said, "No, sir, I'm just hungry." And he said,
"You're acting like a smart aleck."
And I said, "That's how I act when I get hungry." Then I said, "I wish you wouldn't stand on my feet when you hit me. It'll break my ankles when I fall." He said, "I wish you'd get enough nourishment in yourself to get out of New York City." I said, "I don't care."
Hey, you talk about rambling. She's the fastest train on the line.
Hey, you talk about rambling. She's the fastest train on the line. That's that orange blossom special.
Rolling down the seaboard mine.
My daddy left home when I was three. Didn't leave that much for my ma and me. Except this old guitar and an empty bottle of booze. Now, I don't blame him because he run and hid, but the meanest thing that my daddy ever did was before he left, he went and named me Sue. Well, he must have thought that it was quite a joke, and it got a lot of laughs from a lot of folks. Seemed I had to fight my whole life through. Some gal would giggle and I'd turn red, and some guy'd laugh and I'd bust his head. I tell you, life ain't easy for a boy named Sue. But I grew up quick and I grew up mean. My fist got hard, my wits got keen. I roamed from town to town to hide my shame. But I made me a vow to the moon and stars, I'd search the honky-tonks and bars and kill that man and give me that awful name. Well, it was Gatlinburg in mid-July, and I just hit town and my throat was dry. Thought I'd stop and have myself a brew. At an old saloon on a street of mud, and there at a table dealing stud, sat the dirty mangy dog had named me Sue. Well, I knew that snake was my own sweet dad from a worn-out picture that my mother had. Knew that scar on his cheek and his evil eye. He was big and bent and gray and old, and I looked at him and the blood ran cold. And I said, "My name is Sue. How do you do? Now you're gonna die." That's what I told him. Well, I hit him hard right between the eyes, and he went down. But the knife fried. Come up with a knife and cut off a piece of my ear. Then I busted a chair right across the teeth, and we crashed through the walls and into the street, kicking and gouging in the mud, the blood, the fear. Well, I'll tell you, I fought tougher men, but I really can't remember when. He kicked like a mule and he bit like a crocodile. Well, I heard him laugh and then I heard him cuss and reach for his gun, but I pulled mine first and he stood there looking at me and I saw him smile. And he said, "Son, this world is rough, and if a man's gonna make it, he's gotta be tough. I knew I wouldn't be there to help you along. So I gave you that name and I said goodbye, and I knew you'd have to get tough or die. Is that name that'll help to make you strong?" He said, "Now you just fought one hell of a fight, but I know you hate me and you got the right to kill me now, and I wouldn't blame you if you do. But you ought to thank me before I die for the gravel in your gut and the spit in your eye, because I'm the son of a named you Sue. What could I do? Well, I got all choked up and threw down the gun. I called him a paw and he called me a son. Come away with a different point of view. And I think about it now and then, every time I try and every time I win. And if I ever have a, boy, I'll name him Frank or George or Bill or Tom or anything but Sue. I don't want him go around me and call Sue all his life. It's a horrible thing to do to a boy. Why should I want this girl? Name a boy Sue."
Thank you very much.
I tell you, when we came over here to film the show, I thought I might try and have something heavy to say, but I really ain't in a position to preach to anybody. I think all of us have, at one time or another, misjudge something that we thought we saw. It was turned out to be something else. So I'll just let this song say what I feel. I hope some of you can dig it. It's called A Flower Out of Place.
Every stand and criticize a fellow man as he goes by. We point and say there was a disgrace. Well, who are we to know how much kindness is in his soul? For a weed is just a flower out of place. Maybe when he wears his best, it's not as nice as we can dress. And perhaps his features show a blemished face. That don't mean his self-respect has the slightest defect. For a weed is just a flower out of place. We've no more right to breathe, yeah, the air goes to breathe, and the next man, no matter what his faith or race, though his idols aren't as yours, him they're just as sure, and the weed is just a flower out of place. Criticize a fellow man as he goes by. We point and say there was a disgrace. Well, who are we to know how much kindness is in his soul? For a weed is just a flower out of place. Maybe when he wears his best, it's not as nice as we can dress. Perhaps his features show a blemished face. That don't mean his self-respect has the slightest defect. For a weed is just a flower out of place. We've no more right to breathe, the air that blows to breathe, than the next man, no matter what his faith or race. Though his idols aren't as yours, to him they're just as sure. And a weed is just a flower out of place. One person values much, another may not even care. For life is full of many dreams to chase. The code of ethics one rejects might be held high by the next. For a weed is just a flower out of place. You may boast that you're unique, but I'm sure you'd be slow to speak if measured by the Ten Commandments' grace. Let's not be too quick to judge, and let's not feel quite so smug. For a weed is just a flower out of place. Yes, the weed is just a flower out of place. Weed is just a flower out of place.
Thank you.
In the night, praise.